إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، فإن خير الحديث كلام الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. It took me 10 months to collect this book by the help and aid of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So I don't know how I can, you know, finish this lecture today in 1 hour. So let's head directly to the topic. Alaykum as-salam. Page 75 here talks about an interesting notion that many Muslims these days keep repeating. That is Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab rahimahullah being a secret agent of the British government. He definitely wasn't a secret agent or a public agent. Let's talk about some dates. He was born in 1115 Hijriya, which is 1703, and died in 1206 Hijriya, which is 1792. Between that, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab spent a good number of years in the beginning of his life seeking Islamic knowledge. So here we say about this the following: Ibn Abdul Wahhab and the British Council in Basra, and under that early Wahhabi movement and ties to European powers. First, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab in Basra. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah, left Basra at an early time before he started his da'wah in Arabia. So by the time he went to Basra, he was seeking knowledge. He met some shuyukh of knowledge to learn with them hadith and other aspects of the religion. Wasn't a leader of a tribe or an emir of any province. He wasn't a rich man, famous man, a known man at all. So for the British Council in Basra to want to meet him and make a pact with him was ridiculous. authentic historical reports said that Sheikh Abdul Wahhab died in Huraymilah, Najd in 1153. That's the father of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Years before that, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab had moved back to Huraymilah, which is his hometown. So from this date, 1153, and before that, a few years before that, Ibn Abdul Wahhab returned to Najd, never left Arabia after that. So now we have a few dates. Date of birth, date of death, and he returned from Basra to Huraymilah. After that, his father died in 1153, which is 1740. And he was there for years before his father died. It should be noted that the British military involvement in the Arabian Gulf started in the 19th century, which is 1800. Ibn Abdul Wahhab died in the 17th century. But in the beginning, it was involved in just commercial aspects. It wasn't there as a major military power. So it had no real presence in the Arabian Gulf. By the time the British consulate was recognized in Basra, it was 1767. So from, let's say, even if he went back to Huraymilah just days before his father died in 1153, which is 1740, The first British council who was approved by the Uthmani Khilafa during that time came in 1767. What's the difference here? Let's talk. 27 years. How did he meet him then? Where? Because that British council in Basra never came to Arabia. And he came to Basra 27 years at least after Ibn Abdul Wahhab left it. How did they meet? We have to rule out, I think safely, faxes, the internet, the British postal service in the evening and the day, and any other means of him meeting him, because why would he even want to meet him? He wasn't a known person in any way or form. So 1740 he left Basra. 1767 the first British Council came. After 1740 he never went back or left Arabia. How did he meet the British Council? It's a fabrication, unsupported by a shred of evidence. That's why I want to tell you, brothers, make it easy. When they tell you he was a British agent, he met the British Council, whatever, prove it. Give us some kind of history to prove it. Not a desire. Let me say a few words here, and I don't know how I can finish in 1 hour, but anyway, we'll try, inshallah, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Which nation slanders its own leaders? Which nation slanders its own leaders and reformers? This only happens by the hands of the Jews. When they were tested by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and they failed in the test, and many of them became idol worshippers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent them trouble, and they were captured and moved to Iraq for 70 years before they were allowed to go back to Palestine. During that time, they were very miserable. And they hated their own selves. So they changed the book of Allah with their own hands. And changed the seerah of their prophets. Made them to look like murderers. Zina. People. People who have no moral standard of any way. Or of any level. And then they trashed their own history. Their own people. Their own leaders. But in our nation, it's the opposite. It should be. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah rahimahullah said, if you ask the Jews who are the best among you, they will say the companions of Musa alayhi salam. If you ask the Christians who are the best members of your ummah, they will say the disciples of Isa alayhi salam. If you ask the Rafidah who are the worst of your ummah, they'll say the companions of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. The worst. We shouldn't fall into that trap, because those who claim or make these claims are the enemies of the da'wah of Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. There was no reason for him to meet any British council, because Arabia was outside the sphere of influence of the British Empire and even the Khilafah. And this is something maybe you'd want to ask me about later. But Arabia, especially Najd area, was not under direct control of the Khilafah for a long time before Ibn Abdul Wahhab was born. And I would imagine maybe, so what would have happened in the meeting between Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and the British Council? What's the da'wah of Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab? Simply, to resurrect Tawheed in the area where Tawheed started flowing from there to all over the world. During his time, when he started growing up, he noticed many, many things. The people went back to the ways of shirk that Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam came back to destroy. They stopped praying and zakah, and what is worse, they had superstitious ideas. So they started going around graves, invoking the dead, revering trees and stones. The shirk that Rasulullah ﷺ came to destroy. And Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, at an early age, started learning the knowledges of Islam by scholars of Sunnah and Hadith in his time, who emphasized to him the value of Tawheed and how we should bring it back to the life of the Muslims. Also, Arabia was divided into many, many, many tribes and Imarat, which is a leadership of small pieces of land fighting with each other all the time. Those who were happy to go to Hajj expected not to go back home alive, because on the way, many tribes will attack them, take their money, and it wasn't safe for them. So Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, what was his mission? To bring back Tawheed and the practices of the Sunnah in the life of the Ummah. Now, the British Empire, as a defender of Christianity and the commercial benefits of Europe, especially Britain, what need would they have for this man? So, maybe I would imagine just a conversation that went between them had they met. They never met, of course. So the British Council would say to Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, we're angry, because the Arabs are divided, they're weak, they went back to shirk, they don't practice the religion. didn't do salah or siyam or zakah, we would like you to go as our secret agent to take them back to tawheed and to the salah and siyam and zakah. And we say, okay, I'll do that. For no money, of course, exchanged, because there is no historical proof that he received money from anyone other than Muhammad ibn Sa'ud, rahimahullah. Also, no weapons involved, because during that time, the traditional weapons were available anyway. Do you think that conversation ever happened? So between a reformer who wants to bring back Tawheed and an empire that took upon itself to fight the Muslims again after they led one of the last crusades, especially the one that made Salah al-Din, that's the British Empire. They want to bring back, they want to emphasize Christianity, and they know that the biggest competitor for their religion is Islam, and that the Muslims are asleep, and they wanted to use the chance to keep them that way. Let me tell you, brothers and sisters, there is no way that the British Empire would have contacted Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, because what he did afterwards is emphasizing Tawheed and the principles of Islam and faith and practice. This contradicts the mission and goal of all Christian powers, especially the British Empire. So it couldn't have happened. But it's a shame that so many Sunnis, because they don't read their own history, they come and tarnish the image of this Imam of Sunnah and repeat what the Kuffar say about him and repeat what those who are deviant sects say about him. And therefore, he was one of our imams. You should look into that very seriously and not accept any of these rumors. So again, he was born 1115 Hijriya, which is 1703, died 1206, which is 1792. 1740, he left Basra and joined his father, who died a few years after that in Huraymila, which is their hometown. And the first British council to arrive at Basra came in 1767, 27 years after he left Basra. So Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab never had the opportunity to meet that British council, and I don't think he would even think about it in any way or form, because in the Arabian Gulf, the British presence was very minimal, and it was only mainly to protect their commercial interest. Maybe I should stop now for maybe if you have any comment on what I just said, if there is any other, comment, or maybe a doubt you had, inshallah ta'ala, let me know before I go forward, inshallah. Is there any questions? So were you okay with that?
There's a question.
Yes.
Can I ask now? Or
yes, go ahead, inshallah.
Yeah, there is saying that in the time of Imam Muhammad ibn Wahhab, there was a lot of killing. So he imposed Wahhabism to... he killed so many people to impose Wahhabism.
There were wars, yes, between the Islamic State that he started with Muhammad ibn Saud and those who opposed it. But a lot of killing, that's not true. Inshallah, let's address this later on. About the topic of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and the European powers, especially the British, because we hear these days many times people say he was a British spy. A British spy couldn't have a mission of bringing back Tawheed. A British spy would be doing the opposite. And we know that in European countries, even today, if somebody comes with a deviant idea, practices, those governments support them. In America, for example, I reside in America now, between America and Jordan. For years now, they're bringing the name of some shuyukh. Sheikh doesn't mean a scholar. It might, because Iblis is Shaykh al-Dalalah, that's what he's called. But this, a man who's deviant, really, in a big way, but he's portrayed in the American media as the first genuine American imam or scholar, because he was born there. But what he teaches is something that's drastically different from what Rasulullah ﷺ came with. They give him support, they give him media coverage, and so those Western powers, they will never support an Islamic state that calls to Tawheed. The next question, sorry, I have to screen. Did he start a new sect? Okay, this is page 600. Let's go to that. I can't talk more about him being a spy because the dates are clear. Unless somebody comes with a contract between Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and the British Council, where he promises to bring back Tawheed to Arabia, and they promise to give him nothing for that. Other than that, there is no historical evidence that he ever met any British or any European power representative or had anything to do with them. بإذن الله عز وجل, when we talk about the sects now, about him inventing a new madhab, school of thought. Now, by that time, it's obvious that many or most of the Muslim nation was divided into the four traditional schools of fiqh. And they inherited this generation after generation until they thought that this is the truth and the only way to practice the religion. And therefore, if someone comes with something outside of these four madhahib, then he must be doing a bid'ah, inventing a new sect or a new madhab. Now, we have to understand, like, here's a person, his name Minhaj Harun, said that the Uthmani state instructed some of its scholars to falsely ascribe statements to Ibn Abdul Wahhab that were supported by, unsupported by what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has revealed, to make people think that he came with a fifth madhab. A fifth madhab to the people there, what's going on? This is a bid'ah. This is the sunnah, just four madhahib. To be five, to make it witr, doesn't happen. It has to be four. Three doesn't work, four. But Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, as we know from the scholars that he learned with, including his own father, who was a major scholar of the Hanbali madhab in Huraymila, and then Dar'iyya, the Imam learned and practiced the Hanbali madhab. And he didn't invent a new madhab at all, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, gave him the wisdom not to make it too obvious or too much for him and his followers. They contradicted the people in Tawheed. And with regards to the madhab, he didn't really emphasize, you know, the madhahib that we should or shouldn't follow them or whatever. Why? Because he wanted to make things easy for his people. You know, look what they did to him and how they fought him and his people and slandered him until today for bringing back Tawheed. What if he added to that, telling them, let's follow the Quran and Sunnah with the Sahaba and use the madhahib only to benefit from some of their rulings? But Imam ibn Abdul Wahhab was a renowned scholar of the Hanbali madhab. And we have to understand here that with regards to the madhahib, here we have Dr. Twaim. He said, many Orientalists hold the view that the mission of Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was a purifying reformist mission dedicated to return the people to the methodology of the way of Salaf al-Salih. So even the Orientalists during that time understood his mission to be about returning to the way of Salaf al-Salih. Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab wrote books on the Hanbali madhab, and he also gave fatawa according to the Hanbali madhab. He emphasized in, you know, in some of his speeches that we follow the madhahib and we encourage everyone to follow the madhahib. And even his son, Abdullah, the son of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, who was a major scholar himself, wrote that from the Sunnis, we only accept from them that they should follow one of the four madhahib. He was wise in doing that because, you know, the sectarian strife between Muslims then was very big. And therefore, they wanted to control at least the differences between Muslims into what happened between the four madhahib. So Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was a scholar of the Hanbali madhab. Some of the books that we translated for him are clearly on the lines of the Hanbali madhab. And he never said in any way or form that don't follow this madhahib, desert them. What we want to say that the Uthmani Khilafah by that time, by the way, did what the the Abbasi Khilafah. During the time of the Abbasi Khilafah, they almost forced the state to become a Hanafi in madhab. And therefore, the Mufti of the Khilafah during the time of the Uthmanis was a Hanafi. And the scholars were mainly Hanafi. Those who received support from the state were Hanafi. But they tolerated the other three madhab. And therefore, when they come and say that Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab said that we should abandon those four madhahib, and you read the books that he wrote, you'll find the difference between the slander and the reality. Because they emphasize the fact that the four imams were imams of Sunnah, and therefore they didn't object to people following one of the madhahib, to the extent that Abdullah ibn Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab wrote in one of his letters saying, from the Sunnis, we only expect them or accept from them to follow one of the four madhahib. Now, about the madhahib, Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, of course, what he did is that what the imams before him did. When there is a ruling that is not supported from the or a fiqh issue from the Hanbali madhab that's not supported by the Quran and Sunnah or by hadith, he would follow the hadith. But he would, you know, follow mainly the principles of the Hanbali madhab in many ways and many of its fatawa. Until today, you see the scholars of the area that people call to Saudi Arabia, until today, the scholars mainly follow the Hanbali madhab and the fiqh. That's what you see in their writings, in their fatawa. Why would they do that? I mean, here, let's talk about the connection between Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahimahullah and his madhab, and the Salafi way that we emphasize these days. Among the four imams, Imam Ahmad had the most knowledge in the Sunnah. It is reported that among all the scholars of Islam, he memorized more than 2 million narrations. And no scholar before or after was mentioned to memorize as many ahadith as he did. Bukhari memorized 600,000, according to Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani. So Imam Ahmad was a supercomputer, if you want to call him that way, where he collected 2 million narrations. That doesn't mean there are 2 million different ahadith. Many of those ahadith are repeated, statements from the Sahaba, weak ahadith, added ahadith, fabricated ahadith. But he memorized 2 million narrations, Imam Ahmad. And this is why the scholars called him Imam of Ahl Sunnah wal Jama'ah. The stance he took with regard to the Aqidah, when the fitna started by Al-Ma'mun, that required the scholars to agree with his invented idea that he took from the Mu'tazila, that the Quran was one of the creations of Allah, it was a created being or something, Imam Ahmad rejected that. And because of that, he was sent to jail, flogged, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala elevated him in the ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam because of that stance. So the Salafis of today, you might find that so many scholars among the Salafi movement want to follow many of the things that Imam Ahmad said because his madhab was founded more than the other three imams on the ahadith. It's natural because he memorized 2 million ahadith. And can you imagine that? Imam Bukhari, when he came to Baghdad, the scholars of Baghdad heard about him and about his memory power. One of the imams of Islam was saying that when we met al-Bukhari and another scholar of hadith, his name is al-Dhuhali, wanted to discuss some ahadith with al-Bukhari, he would mention the hadith al-Bukhari, al-Bukhari would fly with it so quickly, giving him the narrations and the chains and everything, like he was flying, this is how fast he was in recalling those ahadith. So Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal was a major scholar of hadith, and as I said, 2 million narrations. So there is a great connection between the Salafi movement and Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal. But we don't call to strict following of the madhahib, but that we should learn, inshallah ta'ala, from the madhahib through them, and always go back to the sunnah so that we can, bi'idhnillah azza wa jal, take the benefit from them and then follow the sunnah whenever there are instances where there are fatawa that are clearly unsupported by the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when the Uthmani Empire or state instructed some of the scholars to say that Ibn Abdul Wahhab wrote a new madhab, it was a justification for them to discount him, make the people think ill of him, and reject his message. This is similar to calling the movement Wahhabi movement. There is no such thing as Wahhabi movement. Inshallah Azza wa Jal, I want you to remember this. First of all, his name is Muhammad, son of Abdul Wahhab. So his father is Abdul Wahhab. The people who wanted to defy his message and reject him and slander him, if they call the movement Muhammadi movement, people would think, oh, mashallah, so he's connected to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So they thought that to escape from that, let's call him Wahhabi. Who's al-Wahhab? Allah. So they escaped from calling him after Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They called him after the name of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You see the failure here on their part in two ways. They wanted to defame him, but they ascribed his method or group or reformist movement to al-Wahhab alayhi subhanahu wa ta'ala, escaping from calling him Muhammadi after Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Who called that group Wahhabi? Again, it's the British. The first person who actually mentioned the word Wahhabi, and we have a recorded, you know, a record of that, is a captain, British captain called Sadler. And he sent to Ibrahim Pasha, who was instrumental in destroying the first Saudi state, telling him, congratulating him for destroying the Wahhabi state. So among all the records we find a British soldier who gave that name to the movement to Ibrahim Pasha, the son of Ali Pasha, Muhammad Ali Pasha. Now we have to remember something, brothers. During that time, Egypt was almost completely under French influence. And Muhammad Ali actually allowed the French Navy to, for the first time, you know, go into the Red Sea. So the first ruler who allowed the French to be in the Red Sea was Muhammad Ali. And he's the one who got instructions from the Khilafah al-Uthmaniyah, which was very weak, to go into Arabia and destroy the Wahhabi movement by calling them deviants, those who brought another sect. And then the other jokes that we hear, that they met with the British Council or whatever it is. But when Ali Pasha went into Arabia, he found resistance there, and he was defeated actually many times until he, you know, destroyed the Wahhabi state according to them. So the British were happy for the destruction of the state, and they gave a letter of congratulation to the emir or leader who destroyed it. So again, how can this prove in any way that Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was connected to the British Empire? Now, I didn't want to spend too much time on these things because we have to go back to talking, inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, about the mission of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. And inshallah ta'ala, going to page 673 here. I'm not sure if you have the book, if you can turn to that. Otherwise, inshallah, maybe later on we'll get the book and then remember these pages. This is the mission of Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. He called to the pure tawheed that Allah sent down to his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and warned against shirk, its methods, and against bid'ah, fallacies, fanaticism, and superstition. From shirk, we get that information that the Arab people during that time, they went back to the ways of shirk. They started worshipping graves, the dead, trees, and it was so bad that let me give you two examples. One of them, they would go again and put ropes around or on trees for invoking the tree for help and support, just like the people did before. And women who didn't have children, they would be given the instruction, there is a blessed tree there and a branch of it, go have sex with that branch and you will have a child. And they used to do that, it was popular among them. So when an Imam of Islam comes into this condition, what do you think he's going to do? He's going to definitely emphasize Tawheed and call people against shirk and also fanaticism and superstition. Arabia then was divided again like it was before Islam into tribes and Imarat, fighting with each other. Now, during the era when Ibn Abdul Wahhab started his da'wah, the majority of the people of Najd and the rest of the Muslim world had adopted the very methods that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had forbidden. They learned these methods from their forefathers. The young among them were raised to think that this is the way to be a Muslim and how to practice the religion. And they were offended by the call of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and thought that his way belittled and demeaned their traditions and the ways they inherited from their forefathers. They were offended by the fact that Sheikh Ibn Abdul Wahhab exposed their practices as being polytheistic and acts of jahiliyyah. This was especially true among those who were perceived to be knowledgeable, because by that time, if the majority of the people follow a specific way, the scholars now, they didn't want to defy the masses, so they went along with the people, allowed them to do these things without giving them da'wah that it is jahiliyyah. This was especially true among those who were perceived to be knowledgeable, who thought that if they followed the way of the sheikh, the status they earned and gained will be demolished and would diminish. They were afraid that if they followed the sheikh's call, their people would question their sincerity and tell them that, how come you were silent all these years when we were doing all kinds of shirk and bid'ah, and now when this man came and reminded you about the Islam, now you're saying, yeah, his way is the true way. So they were afraid from both sides, on both sides, losing the gains and the leadership, and being criticized by the people that they were telling you deceived us all these years. You didn't tell us about the truth. They feared that the commoners might think that the sheikh proved the leaders and teachers ignorant in the religion and deviant if they abandoned their practices and followed the way of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Some of their leaders and teachers actually believed in those deviant ideas and practices. Whatever the cause, the call of Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab faced stiff resistance from his contemporary so-called scholars who rejected the truth and used useless arguments and defamation as their tool to reject and attack the sheikh's methodology. Having failed to refute the da'wah of Sheikh Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab using valid evidence or statements from aerial scholars, the deviant teachers and political leaders who felt threatened by the widespread acceptance of the call of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab instead erected obstacles in the path of the da'wah by committing outright aggression against it and against its followers. Now, to go back to the question of the brother. So here's the Imam, he comes at a time when the people went back to the ways of jahiliyyah and shirk. He learned with the scholars of hadith and sunnah in his time that this is shirk and this is jahiliyyah. He went to Mecca, he went to Medina, never went to Damascus or Al-Qahira or Egypt, but he went to Iraq, Basra, and came back to Najd with that knowledge and started the call to Tawheed when he got back. When he came back to his area, it was even more difficult on him after having gained knowledge to see all these practices widespread among his people. So he started calling them to Tawheed and to reform their practices and to go back to the Salah and the Zakah, which was almost forgotten, nobody paid Zakah, and to the other aspects of the religion, and to go to the honorable way of doing things in our life with regards to our honor that the Sahaba and the Ummah of Islam did since the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So the teachers now, they have a problem, because their influence over the people was based on them agreeing with the people to what they did and not criticizing them. Here's a sheikh comes who has vast knowledge. He learned the 6 books of hadith, which usually means by heart, and then many other, you know, books of Islam, and he's well-founded in the Aqidah, and he comes and argues with those scholars and offers, you know, Tawheed as compared to what they were offering people. And they wanted to put obstacles in his way, slandering, calling him that he brought a fifth madhab, or whatever it is that they were saying, until the moment when they decided and realized that they can't do anything against this da'wah until they start fighting. Therefore, they started telling the Bedouin groups and nations around Dar'iya, especially after he made the pact with Muhammad ibn Sa'ud, rahimahullah, to attack them and to take every opportunity to kill their members or to detain them, kidnap them. This reminds me very much with the time of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Soon after the Sahaba went to Medina, before Badr, Muslims were weak. And the Muslims were afraid that people will kidnap them and give them to Mecca, for example. They were not safe. And the Bedouins and tribes of all of Arabia were against them. Imam Ibn Qayyim, rahimahullah, describes that as there was only one arrow and the whole Arabia was that arrow that was directed at Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and the Sahaba. Same thing here. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab found a leader in Muhammad ibn Saud who was willing and able to defend the da'wah. So Ibn Abdul Wahhab did not revolt against any state. He went to a place in Najd, Dar'iyah, that was ruled by a man whose name is Muhammad ibn Saud, and asked him for support, and he gave him that support. The Bedouins now and the tribes that rejected the message of Tawheed again, they thought that this is going to be very dangerous, because now he have an Amir of a state who's supporting him. So they directed their attacks at that Amir. Most of the early battles that happened were in defense of themselves. Then they started attacking these people in their areas, and they had every right to do that. Why? First of all, they're transferring and bringing back the message of Tawheed, and those were the barriers between them and reaching the people. Remember, among the goals of jihad and why it starts is that when there is a barrier between the Islamic message and a certain people because of authority or whatever it is, jihad now starts to remove that barrier. It's the same thing here. And many battles happened. There were deaths on both sides. But Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab did not call for that or seek it. It happened because those people started attacking him, and then they responded. One of the letters Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab sent, by the way, it really touched me deeply, because he said that when we came with this message, which is clear, it's the Quran, it's the Sunnah, it's Tawheed, this is Shirk, this is Bid'ah, we anticipated support from the Uthmani Khilafah, being the leader of Muslims, you know, representative of Islamic State. But we were deeply touched because of their behavior, that they called other people to come fight us, they fought us, they rejected us, and because of that, we suffered and they suffered. This is found here to tell you about the grief that Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab had when people opposed him. So for the reformation movement that he came with, it wasn't a Khawarij da'wah in any way. He didn't revolt against any ruler at all. And they didn't attack the people around Dar'iyah, for example, the state, that's the state capital of the Imara of Bani Saud. It was a small Imara in Najd. They didn't attack people to begin with. They attacked them. Then they went out of their area to remove the barriers between them and reaching the da'wah. Subhanallah. Just like what happened at the time of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu. When all of Arabia went back to kufr and shirk, or they reverted, or they stopped praying, giving zakah, and Abu Bakr and Umar were having a discussion about that, and then Abu Bakr decided that we should fight these people, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the power and the patience to send army after army after army. If you read the history of the Hurub al-Ridda, where people, you know, reverted from the religion, so many armies went to so many towns, and like Khalid ibn Walid, Amr ibn al-As would take the task of going through different towns, different tribes. They fought so many tribes with so few soldiers, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them victory. It reminds me of the same thing here, because Muhammad ibn Saud, he soon died, rahimahullah. And here is a man who used to be, before Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab came to his town, just another tribal leader. Didn't care much about what's going on or what his own people are practicing, shirk, tawheed, bid'ah. Also, his main concern was taxing the smaller tribes around his area. So when Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab came and said, give me the pledge to support the da'wah, among the things that Muhammad ibn Saud mentioned, he said, what about the tax I used to collect from the tribes? Because that was, important money. He said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you from the victories that Allah may give us if these people opposed us. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did. So they started, you know, expanding around Dar'iyah until they took almost all of the Arabi, or the next section of Arabia. Muhammad ibn Saud died. His son came. Now Muhammad ibn Saud didn't learn much before that about the religion. You see that shortly after he met Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he became a scholar. This is the effect, the impact that Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab had on people. He would give them the enthusiasm to learn Tawheed, learn Sunnah. As soon as a tribal leader, literally a Bedouin, became a scholar. His son Abdul Aziz ibn Muhammad ibn Saud is even a bigger scholar than Muhammad. He was a major scholar during that time. And if you read the things that he was teaching and the eloquence that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him, you'll be amazed about the transformation. Abdul Aziz now, mashallah, ruled until the so-called Wahhabi movement took over Mecca and Medina. There is another story behind that, but the time, you know, is short to talk about it. But they entered Mecca and Medina after many tricks and games and acts of betrayal happened from the rulers of Mecca and Medina, and they had to enter it when the son of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab had died by the time they entered Mecca and Medina, when his son Abdullah came with the army of Abdul Aziz ibn Muhammad ibn Saud, and they entered Mecca. He entered in the same way Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered. Because we know from the history of the seerah that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Mecca to our Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he entered it, he was riding his camel. He didn't ride it with go through Mecca with his head held high. Like, here, I am back, I'm victorious. He was literally making sujood on top of the jamal, so that he shows Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala his appreciation and showing humbleness that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him the victory. So Abdullah ibn Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab did the same thing when he entered Mecca, so humble. And they protected the people of Mecca, respected them. But they did something that you might want to ask about, because we're talking here about the mission of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Someone asked me about the mission of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Was it to force everyone and to write the names of everyone and then see if they come to the salah, otherwise they flog them? I'd say yes, but only in Mecca. Because in Mecca, where Al-Kaaba is here, right in front of you, many people during that time did not make the salah. Can you understand this? I mean, it's really huge. I can't understand it. But this is Al-Kaaba. The adhan, five times a day, they don't go to the salah. They don't make salah. So when Abdullah ibn Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab entered Mecca, realizing how people fell back to this miserable state, only in that area, what they did is that they gathered all the males who are required to be at the masjid, of course. You know, we should remember, the males should pray all five salawat at the masjid. So they gathered the males, took their names, and divided, you know, the people into groups, where a few people will be taking care of every group. So you don't come for Fajr tomorrow. You find a guest coming to your house, asking you, why didn't you come? Were you sick? Were you tired? You need help? No, I'm okay. I was just sitting here. Oh, tomorrow we have to see you at the masjid. If they didn't come the second day, the third day they will go take them from their home and flog them. Why wouldn't they do that if it is around the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? But this is not the way that they did in everywhere else. So it's their mission was to bring back the value of Islam and its practices in the life of Muslims. In some areas they were harsh. That's the question of the brother, you know. They are called harsh. Why is it that they were called harsh? It's because they called to Tawheed. You see, when someone has developed a way that's different than the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam and his Sahaba, and they got used to it, and you come and tell them, you know, your way is not the way, in the best way you can. You've been living, you know, in a different way than the way of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam. People don't want to change their behavior or their life. And therefore, when you come and tell them about something, a mistake, Shaitan tells them all the time that, this man thinks he's better than you. Or he tells them, look at their demeanor, they're, you know, harsh. What's harsh? What does harsh mean here? Musa alayhi salam, when he was in the meeting with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and received the Torah, he went back and found his people, you know, worshipping the cow. What did he do? He went after his brother Harun, who was a prophet from Allah, and took him by the hair on his head and the beard, and started pulling him by the hair. Until Harun, alayhi salam, said, Yabna oh, son of my mother. He's also son of his father. But he mentioned the mother because it brings compassion and softness. Oh, son of my mother, don't pull me by the hair on my head and my beard, because I told these people, you know, not to do it. They almost killed me. So is this harsh? This is Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Today, if Musa alayhi salam were to come alive and do this to any of us, maybe, you know, people will call for the removal of the Imam and the change of the Prophet. We need another Prophet. We don't like this one. The Salafis these days, no matter what you say to people, they call you harsh. This is what they called Imam Ahmed. This is what they called Imam Ibn Taymiyyah. This is what they called Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Just because you tell people the truth. And the truth means in their case to change their ways, their practices, their life. They don't want to do it, so they call you harsh. There's an experiment that I wanted to do, I forgot. I would go to someone that I wanted to tell them about something they're making, you know, mistaken, to show them, inshallah ta'ala, in the best way I can that they made a mistake. Give them £20, $20. So, brother, this is a gift from me. And smile. Brother, mashallah, jazakallah khair, you come to the masjid. I just have a little thing, you know, advice here. I know you know about it, you know. Your thobe, shorten it above the ankles. They will take the money and call you harsh. Why? Because it means that he has to go back home and do something. That's to his thobe. So it is the way of those who reject the truth, who are stubborn, who don't want to change it, to call people harsh. The fighting that happened between Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and his followers and the people of Najd was mainly in defense of the da'wah and the city. What happened after that was the expansion of the political state, just like Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu did, so that they can bring tawheed to other parts of Arabia. Abu Bakr could have received the same kind of accusation, because so much bloodshed happened in Arabia during the battle or the battles of Ridda. More than, Allah knows best, than what happened during the time of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. But Abu Bakr did it. He brought back the people back under the folds of the Islamic State. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab started it. But let me give you one major reason why many people direct their attack at Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. They oppose Ibn Taymiyyah and his Aqidah, the four Imams and their Aqidah. They oppose the Salafis of our time and the scholars of our time. But Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, as compared to the even the four Imams, may Allah give them his pleasure, radiallahu anhum, even Ibn Taymiyyah, he succeeded in establishing an Islamic state that followed the way of Tawheed and the practices of Sunnah. This kills him. Because as long as the Imam, like Ibn Taymiyyah, was oppressed by the state, he ended up dying in jail, you know, and Ibn al-Qayyim was released from jail after Ibn Taymiyyah died. They were under the control of the state. Now they have the state. So now it is far more dangerous. This is why, you know, these names and slander came. Also, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab had an impression on every Islamic movement that appeared in the Muslim world since then. In India, an entire generation of scholars who together came and started emphasizing Tawheed and the Sunnah together so that they can oppose the British Empire, who then was expanding little by little the European powers. The British in India supported the idea of calling these people Wahhabis and people who brought a fifth madhab. Why? Because Wahhabi would sound maybe strange. What's this Wahhabi? It's another sect like Qadianis, like whatever, you know? And calling them that and making them look like they brought a fifth madhab to reduce the value and the effectiveness of the da'wah of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. And therefore, when we find Muslims today repeating these accusations, we say this is incredible. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this da'wah success to reach almost every part of the world. This is why the scholars of Islam have called the Imam the Mujaddid of Da'wat al-Tawheed, the one who brought it back and resurrected it. Who first used the term Wahhabi? Let's talk about this here. It appears that the British were among the first Westerners to take interest in calling this Da'wah Wahhabism. And the ism in the end, I don't know what it means, because they put ism after everything. I caution you brothers, you know, using what these Westerners have, you know, called our places of worship, they called it mosque. It's not a mosque, it's a masjid. Please use the word masjid. This is what Allah called it. Mosque, we don't know where it came from. whether it's Spanish for mosquito or French or whatever, we don't know who brought it, but mosque is not the name of the place of worship. Plus the language that we have is Arabi, is not Arabic. Bic is a pen, we know that. But Arabi is the language. The C at the end, what does it mean? They have to change the names and sometimes translate the names into their language. So Wahhabism, the reason being that the Dawah reached the most prized colony under British control, India. Many scholars in India embraced and supported the Dawah of Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. Also, the British witnessed the Dawah flourish as its followers included an impressive group of scholars throughout the Muslim world. During that time, Britain was also nurturing the Qadiani sect to replace the mainstream Islamic ideals. They wanted to extend their control over India, relying on a sect of its own creation, the Qadianis, which was British created, British nurtured, and British protected, a sect that did not call for jihad against the British colonialists of India or any part of the Islamic world. So when the Dawah Imam Muhammad Abdul Wahhab started spreading in India, and with it came the slogans of jihad against foreign occupiers, Britain became especially worried. They branded the Dawah and its supporters as Wahhabis to discourage Muslims in India from joining it, in the hope that resistance to the British occupation of India would not intensify. Many scholars who supported the Dawah were captured, put in jail, and killed. So India had a major Sunnah revival movement that coincided with the time of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and after him, and he had a hand in making them enthusiastic because they heard about the victories of the Dawah in Arabia. And even some secularist Arab authors like Taha Hussein, he was secularist, to say the least. But when he spoke about the Dawah of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, he said, when it started, there came the hope in the Muslim and Arab world in specific that the early era of Islam will come back and that the Ummah will unite again and be mighty again. Even a secularist hoped that. It should be noted that in the letters and reports that he submitted to his stepfather and the Uthmanis, Ibrahim Pasha, adopted son of Muhammad Ali Pasha, who ruled Egypt, also used the terms Wahhabis, Khawarij, and Munafiqeen to call the Dawah of Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and the Saudi state. This, of course, occurred before Ibrahim Pasha rebelled against the Khilafah himself. I know, brothers, I really can't talk about this in 1 hour. So maybe I'll come back, inshallah, and sit here for 10 hours and read most of it. What can I do? So much information here. Now, they called the Muhammad Abdul Wahhab as a Khawarij against the Uthmani state. Okay, Arabia wasn't under the rule of the Uthmani state, and the eastern part of Arabia was under the Rashidi tribe, which was Rafida. So Muhammad Abdul Wahhab gave us a service. He took that area from them. Allah khair, Muhammad bin Saud. But that area wasn't under the direct control of the Uthmani Khilafah. Also, Uthmani Khilafah at that time was severely weak. They started calling the Uthmani Khilafah the sick man of Europe way before that. It started already. And it was severely under the protection and support and influence of Western powers, especially Britain, France, and Germany. Read the history. It was a very weak state. Because otherwise they could have sent their own army to attack Arabia. Why would they call Muhammad Ali Pasha in Egypt, help us send an army? Muhammad Ali Pasha was very fascinated about the French, their tradition and their culture, and he wanted to bring it to Egypt. And I said he allowed the French Navy actually to come into the Red Sea and have patrols there. But what happened is that when they asked him to send the army, Muhammad Ali Pasha thought this was a good way for him to train his army, and of course to take over more areas, especially adding Mecca and Medina to his influence. So he sent his adopted son, Ibrahim Pasha, and Ibrahim Pasha suffered, defeats in the beginning. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for a hikmah that he has, allowed him to defeat the Islamic State. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and Muhammad ibn Saud started. That was the first state. And they did a lot of killing and destruction. The two armies, when they met, and they are described here. The so-called Wahhabi army did not have any music or drums, and they prayed on time. To the opposite of the Egyptian army who didn't pray, they brought khamr with them and they had drums. And if some of them prayed, it wasn't like a general movement among them. Ibrahim Pasha is the same person now they call Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. He revolted against the Uthmani Khilafah and did this and did that. So the Uthmani Khilafah brought Muhammad Ali Pasha from Egypt, who sent his son. They made, you know, war, destroyed the first Saudi state. Years after that, Muhammad Ali Pasha had a major dispute with the Uthmani Khilafah. So what did he do? He sent Ibrahim Pasha and quickly defeated the Uthmanis, almost went all the way to Istanbul. Almost, he went all the way to Istanbul. Almost defeated and ended the Uthmani Khilafah. And he didn't stop, but after the British and French Navy surrounded his army in a city, Antakya, in the Mediterranean Sea. So now, you're calling Muhammad al-Abdul Wahhab a Khawarij against the Uthmani Khilafah. The Uthmani Khilafah sent Ibrahim Muhammad Ali Pasha, who sent his son, adopted son. But these are the people who revolted. How come people don't criticize Muhammad Ali for that, but they single out Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab? Doesn't this tell you something, brothers? What he didn't do, he was accused of doing, it's Muhammad Ali and his son who did that. And those armies almost destroyed the Khilafah. But Britain had a game and a mission at that time. Britain wanted to start occupying the Muslim lands easily without having major wars. For the Uthmani Khilafah to be under their influence, to exist and remain alive on life support, it was better for them than it divides, because then they don't know who's going to be the ruler in which area. Let me give you an example, brothers, because you know that the British, they had their armies and navies by then in the Mediterranean. They started going to Iraq and Basra, and this is way after Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab left Basra, as we mentioned. And the British started, you know, connecting between their colonies in India and what they call the Middle East, so they can control all these areas practically. After World War I, what happened? Most of these areas fell under British occupation, because they've been planning this for a very long time. And the Saudi and the Khilafah of Uthmaniyin by that time was extremely weak, a dead state. Another thing that I want to say before, inshallah ta'ala, we try to finish soon. Remember that in the last 50 years in the life of the Uthmani Khilafah, it came under the influence and direct control of a group of Jews who became Muslim for the purpose of reaching high ranks in government and the army. And these are called Jam'iyyat al-Ittihad wa-Taraqqi later on. These are the ones who controlled the Khilafah, people who were truly Jews, who wanted to say things about the Uthmani Khilafah to control it, while at the same time the Uthmani remained among the Muslims that this is the Islamic State. Well, by that time the Khilafah was really weak and divided. Let's talk about one more issue, inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before we finish. I translated here two of the letters on Aqidah that Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab brought. I told you that he was a wise man. Of course, he followed the Hanbali madhab in the major, you know, principles, but he defied the madhab in many ways when there is a hadith against what the Hanbali madhab says. But he didn't make this as a major part of his mission. He wanted to concentrate on Tawheed, because Tawheed is bigger than following the madhab. Now, I wanted to translate two letters the Imam wrote about Aqidah. And I was thinking about this aspect. Most of the Sunni Muslims today, they follow the Hanafi madhab. And Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab is loathed and hated by many of those Hanafis, especially in the sub-Indian continent. I want to help them because I know they got wrong information, and the commoners don't have access to knowledge so they can read and compare and see what's right. You know, they got rumors here and that's stuck there. So they hate the mission of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. They think he was a deviant. They call them Wahhabi, extremists, whatever it is they call them. So I wanted to choose two letters and compare them to Al-Aqidah Al-Tahawiyyah. العقيدة الطحاوية. إمام الطحاوي is one of the major scholars of Islam of all time. Scholar of hadith, fiqh, Arabic, history. And he was married to the daughter of Imam al-Muzani, who was the most famous student of Imam al-Shafi'i. In the beginning, al-Tahawi was a Shafi'i in the madhab. Then when he grew in knowledge, he became a Hanafi in madhab. And he collected a book he called The Aqidah According to the Imams, and he mentioned Imam Abu Hanifa, Abu Yusuf, and Muhammad ibn Hassan al-Shaybani. So Imam al-Tahawi wanted to collect a book for the generations to come, especially since deviant sects appeared in his time and before his time. He wanted to make clear to the people what Imam Abu Hanifa believed in. He wrote Al-Aqidah Al-Tahawiyya. This is accepted by the four madhahib and the scholars of Sunnah as an authentic Aqidah, except for a few parts, and no Imam or Muslim after Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam is immune from error. But that Aqidah, it was called Al-Aqidah Al-Mubarakah, the blessed Aqidah. And therefore, I wanted to make comparisons between the Aqidah of Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and the Aqidah of the Hanafis in specific. And I compared it to Al-Aqidah Al-Tahawiyya and found that what Imam Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab wrote about the Aqidah is almost word to word similar to what Al-Tahawi wrote. And therefore, we wanted to give this to the brothers who don't speak Arabic so that they can listen to the Imam talk about his Aqidah and judge for themselves what he, rahimahullah, used to say. It is really astounding and to find that some Western writers even called the movement of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab reformist, that he wanted to bring back Tawheed and fight Shirk, and that the political influence that the state had was mainly because of this message. Not that they wanted to start a state and then they thought, oh, let's call to Tawheed. They called to Tawheed and Allah gave them success to find Muslim authors and even Imams, you know, give us grief about this Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, who they know he was a deviant, this and that, but they can't read their own books. Let me end with a little bit of a joke, and then inshallah ta'ala we'll entertain your questions. There was a man who trained in an Islamic university to be an imam, a Muslim teacher, you know. He learned in an Islamic university. So once I was sitting with him, and then all of a sudden he said, I'm angry with Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. I said, why? What's the problem? He says, because he gave the kingship to Abdul Aziz bin Saud. I said, wait a minute, there's a problem here. What Abdul Aziz you're talking about? Is it the father of the current king of Saudi? He said, yes. I said, do you know that Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab died, you know, decades before Abdul Aziz was even born? So how can he give him the kingship? Okay? Maybe I came after death and told him, you know, take it and you're the ruler after me. What does this indicate? If someone who goes to university for 4 years, having access to books, been taught by the shuyukh how to read Islamic books and get evidence from it, can get this wrong or become this wrong about the imam, then most of what you have heard, brothers and sisters, is similar to that. Rumors, false accusations, and things that cannot be supported, like the claim that he met with the British Council and became a British spy. We can do this to our scholars and imams. Of course, he made mistakes. During his time, by the way, many battles happened. And those who joined the armies of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, Muhammad ibn Saud, Abdul Aziz ibn Saud, they were Bedouins who just, you know, didn't have much time to learn about the Islamic manner. They were harsh. Some of them were harsh and made killing more than they should. But didn't Khalid ibn Walid, radiallahu anh, the sword of Allah, once kill an entire tribe? And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam raised his hand and said, oh Allah, I disown the action of Khalid. 3 times. Did Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam remove him from the leadership? No. Did Abu Bakr remove him? No. Did Umar remove him? Yes. You know for what? Because he thought that Khalid was getting arrogant. But Khalid, when he died, they went to his house and found nothing in his house except a mat and the horse that he used to ride for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Even Umar radiallahu anhu said, we misjudged Khalid. So Khalid was harsh in some of his battles, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, these are humans. Based on the fact that these people who joined Muhammad Abdul Wahhab were Bedouins, they had harshness in them. Three more minutes, I just want to finish, inshallah. They attacked Karbala. They attacked Karbala, the army of Abdul Aziz ibn Muhammad ibn Saud, in the middle of the day, and killed most of its males and took others captives. What is Karbala? Karbun wa bala. Karbala is the name of the city. Karb, grief, bala, disaster. This is where Al-Hussein is claimed to have died, and he died there. And this is where one of his two heads was buried, because he had two heads. One of them is in Cairo, the other one is in Istanbul. And I can assure you, none of them is his head. They all claim they have the head. He died there. Now, the city of Karbala during that time had turned into Rafidi completely. And the Rafida, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, was shocked to see the practices of the Rafida in Basra. And we saw them today, many of you who didn't grow up in areas like I did in Kuwait that had a lot of Shia, many of you now see that. Time magazine once took a picture of those people who 100 yards or meters before the monument that's built on a grave of one of their imams, they fall to the ground and start swimming in dust. They can't walk there, they have to swim until they get there to the door so they can invoke the dead. About that stuff that they do to themselves, you know, that is so terrible that they use, you know, knives and swords, and they cut themselves and their children. And they, on Time magazine, another issue, they put the picture of a man who had like a 4 or 5 year old son, and he hit him with a sword. They never called this, you know, this is abuse of children. I heard, and the brother is here to confirm, that actually the government here allows him to do this here under, you know, behind doors, closed doors. Just don't show it to the public. But you have to have medical, you know, assistance nearby. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, when he saw all these things, he was shocked. Definitely he transferred the knowledge about al-Rafida and what they do to his students. So the army that attacked Karbala, it was harsh, and I admit that, I admit it here, because we're followers of the truth. We're not, blind followers of anyone, regardless of who he is. We follow the truth. But let's talk about what the Shia did during that time, over from the shirk, and kufr, and rafd, and how they, until today, they do it, they curse the Sahaba. Look at the Houthis now, what they're doing. Those Houthis have become Ja'fari in the past few decades, little by little. They've left the Zaydi madhab, which we are told by the scholars of before that it is the closest Rafidi or Shia madhab to the Sunnah. But now they're different. Over the centuries, they became more and more fanatical against the Sahaba. So these people, the Houthis, they have the almost every idea or practice that the Ja'fari madhab has. Quran was changed and corrupted, so it's not pure. Sunnah doesn't exist. The Sahaba became kuffar. Aisha committed zina. And then they go to the area in Yemen where the Salafis have, you know, their mashallah compound and, you know, have the school. I'm not really familiar with their teacher at all, but I heard that the scholars have called for support for them, including Sheikh Rabi' Hafidhahullah and other scholars. They know him better than me, but anyway, they surround them. They don't allow food or medicine to go into that area. I'm telling you, if you capture their leaders, they might tell you this is in retaliation for what happened in Karbala. Because they did that before. They said that things that they did against the Sunnis, we are going to retaliate for what happened in Karbala. There was harshness in there. But again, these were Bedouins who were by nature tough, didn't have the time to learn the Islamic manners in the best way, but they attacked a city of kufr and shirk. So we need brothers to go back and now understand what this Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab was about, a reformer. All what he wanted to do is bring back tawheed to our life, unite the Muslim ummah under one leadership, bring back the sunnah in our life so we can practice it, and succeeded. And because of the barakah that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala brought with him, maybe the oil, they discovered it today out of a barakah because of him coming to that area. Allah knows best. Until today, the area where he, you know, spread his da'wah and his children until the day, today they are called the Al al-Shaykh, the family of al-Shaykh. Al-Shaykh meaning here Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, the Mufti, the Minister of Awqaf. They're both Al Salih Al Sheikh. Al Sheikh means the family of the Sheikh, which Sheikh Muhammad Al Abdul Wahhab. This is how respected he is until today. That area, as compared to most other Muslim areas, they don't see monuments being worshipped and people going around graves seven times like they do around the Kaaba, or they invoke the dead in public, or they practice acts of shirk in public, because the state now is dedicated to preventing those things from happening. Of course, there are mistakes, there are shortcomings, but think about the bigger picture. What happened before Muhammad Abdul Wahhab started his da'wah, it could have remained until today. And therefore, you go to Mecca or Medina today, you see thousands of monuments and things that are unbelievable. The people go, I was in the graveyard of the Sahaba, Al-Baqi', and then I heard noise, people screaming and shouting. I said, what's going on? Some people, Shia, came to a big grave that they claim Al-Abbas was buried in it, and they have the rumors Al-Abbas was so big that this is why the graves. But there were a few Sahaba maybe buried there, or a few dead people buried in the same grave. And they started screaming, shouting, crying, saying poems. And the guy who was saying poems, he said, like, there is a famous poem that they said that a bird was walking close to a water source, and all of a sudden the bird said a poem of 100 sentences in praise of Al-Hassan Al-Hussein. So they repeat that, they say the bird started it. It's not, an amazing thing, because for Asfur, by the way, you know how Asfur was called Asfur? You know what Asfur is? Asfur is a bird. Every bird in Arabic you call it Asfur. Then we call it the species, but everything that flies we call Asfur. He said Asfur was a creature, his name was Fur. That's what the Shia say. His name was Fur. He was called to submit to the Imamah of Al-Hussein and Ali, and he refused, so his name became Asa Fur Asfur. Fur disobeyed. And one of them, I was listening to him, and he said, I was watching an ant going up the wall and falling. Up the wall and falling. Then I said to the ant, say, Ya Ali, you're not going to fall. And he claimed that it said and it did go up all the way. I'm sure this guy, I don't know what kind of drink he takes, but this is really hilarious. So brothers, when you look at their practices and what they do, it is amazing. Therefore, when those Bedouins who have learned Tawheed now again, mashallah, very enthusiastic about it, they go to people who worship the dead in this manner. They were harsh in the Karbala, but inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you read about the general way that Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab and his people conducted the warfare, it was humane, it was necessary, and what they did is to bring back Tawheed to us, inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I have to apologize, brother. I know that some students of knowledge came here today to listen to some specific things, but I really can't. It's difficult. Here is a 700-page book that took me 10 months of my life to collect. So much information here. It is amazing how much goodness I found in this da'wah. And I encourage you, brothers, inshallah, this book is out of print, but soon, inshallah ta'ala, will reprint it. Buy the book, and bi-idhnillah azza wa jal, you will learn so much about this imam to be like this man. I'm sure, I know, just one more thing, because in Connecticut, we had a center close to us, that big, mashallah, and was always, mashallah, most of the population, the people who go there from Indian subcontinent, Pakistan and India. And I know that they have a lot of rumors that they heard about the imam. So I brought this book, and we spoke to some brothers, said, buy boxes of books so we can give them away for free. I don't want to sell it. I'm not a merchant. So we went there and had a couple of hundred books distributed. I saw a man older than me, I'm 50, he's at least 60. And he was the principal of the school. He was looking at the book, then looking away and looking at the book. So I came near him and said, what's going on, brother? He said, all my life, I've been hearing bad things about this man. I said, this is your chance now to learn the good things about him. And the bad things you heard mainly came from kuffar, Don't allow the kuffar to tell you who's a good Muslim and who's a bad Muslim. You do it yourself. He read it and came back and said, he's an imam. Definitely. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us knowledge in the religion, make us among the righteous. If you have any questions, inshallah. Yes. Riyadh didn't exist then. Specifically, you know, remember which? Yeah, some areas, Jazakallah khair, this is a good reminder. I haven't read my own books in a couple of years, so I don't remember everything here. But Jazakallah khair for the reminder. You know, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was leading the salah, and he made mistake in the recitation in the book that came to him. And then he said afterwards, was Ubay here? He said, yeah, I am here. Why didn't you correct me? So this is a good reminder, Jazakallah khair. One of the areas surrounding, close to Dar'iyya, it took Muhammad ibn Sa'ud and his successors 10 years to control that area. This is how patient they were. They could have attacked it and did to it what they did to Karbala later on, but it took them 10 years negotiations, telling these people, you know, come to us, we're gonna call you to Quran and Sunnah. Subhanallah, 10 years until they attacked it, but then when they attacked it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave them control over it. The bloodshed that people think happened during that time, in my view, it was minimal because you have hundreds and hundreds of tribes. And the warfare against him and his da'wah was so tremendous that it was unbelievable. But when you look at the number of dead, it wasn't really that much. There are historians who wrote about those battles. Inshallah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you find some of them here, some of the incidents and history about those battles. One thing that, you know, of course, when they said that, they said the army of the believers and the army of the mushrikeen. So there was a little bit of harshness here, but it was clear. Those who come support Tawheed, they should be called the army of the believers, inshallah. And those who supported shirk and wanted to keep the status as it is of the ummah, which is backward, ignorant, and deviant, and on a way of shirk that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to destroy, they should be called in some fashion the mushrikun.
The first written question, inshallah, to the Shaykh. Assalamu alaikum. Can you please clarify the hadith about the horns of the devil rising from Najd? Is this Abdul Wahhab?
The devil, his name was Iblis. It wasn't Muhammad Abdul Wahhab, that's to begin with. Yes, inshallah, we can talk about this. I mean, because it's funny how some people would use this against the da'wah of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. We said it's a reformist movement. What did he call people to? Did he call people to drinking, to taking ahkam from the Torah, to do shirk, to abandon salah, siyam, don't pay zakah? What he called the people to is tawheed, to abandon shirk, to follow the sunnah, and to practice the pillars of Islam. And therefore, his da'wah should tell you about him without calling, you know, or hearing what the people say about Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab being from Najd, and Najd is where shaitan, the horn of shaitan come. Let's talk about this, inshallah. Okay, here I'm going to read from the laptop, the same book. Wahhabiyya appeared in Najd, land of turmoil, where the devil's horns appear. Enemies of the da'wah of Imam Muhammad Abdul Wahhab often mention this hadith as clear proof they claim to the deviant nature of this da'wah and its followers. What's the hadith? Al-Bukhari narrated this hadith from Abdullah ibn Umar. Qala Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allahumma barik lana fi shamina wa fi yamanina. Oh Allah, give us blessing and barakah in our Sham and our Yemen. By the way, that during that time, Sham and Yemen were not part of the Islamic State. But he was telling, this is a mu'jiza, huh? He was telling them, Sham, Yemen, meaning you're going to be controlling those areas. Oh, Allah give us barakah in those areas. It's one of the prophecies of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. قَالُوا وَفِي نَجْدِنَا. They said, what about our Najd? He said, Allahumma barik lana fi shamina wa fi yamanina. Again. قالوا وفي نجدنا قال هناك الزلازل والفتن وبها يطلع قرن الشيطان. Oh Allah, bless our Sham, which is Syria and Jordan and Lebanon and Palestine and our Yemen. The people said, what about our Najd? The Prophet ﷺ said again, Oh Allah, bless our Sham and our Yemen. They again said, our Najd as well. The Prophet ﷺ said, there will appear earthquakes and afflictions. There will appear, meaning Najd, earthquakes and afflictions. And from there will come out the side of the head or horn of the shaitan. It is sufficient to refute this false claim by simply reporting another hadith found in Sahih Muslim and collected from the same companion, Abdullah ibn Umar. Now listen, they say Najd, shaitan, horn, Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab. But Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab called to the opposite of what shaitan, you know, wants. Imam Muslim reported from Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he said that shaitan has given up hope that the believers in Arabia will obey him and worship him. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab called for disobeying shaitan and disbelieving in him. So they can't be together. But look at this sufficient, inshallah, refutation. Muslim narrated that Salim, son of Abdullah ibn Umar, said, O people of Iraq, how strange it is that you ask about minor sins but commit major sins. I heard my father, Abdullah ibn Umar, narrate that he heard Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam say, while pointing his hand towards the east. Najd in Arabic means east. Remember, Najd is not only an area, it's also a direction. So Najd means east. إِنَّ الْفِتْنَةَ تَجِيءُ مِنْهَا هُنَا إِنَّ الْفِتْنَةَ تَجِيءُ مِنْهَا هُنَا مِنْ حَيْثُ يَطْلُعُ قَرْنَا الشَّيْطَانِ. The turmoil will come from this side, the east, from where appear the two horns of shaitan. Imam al-Khattabi said, Najd pertains to areas lying to the east. Thus, the Iraqi desert and surrounding areas is the Najd of Medina. So he was talking about what? About Muhammad Abdul Wahhab and Najd of today? No, he was talking about the direction of the east. He pointed to the direction of the east and said, this is where the shaitan's horn will come from. Salim, son of Abdullah ibn Umar, was criticizing the people of Iraq. Thus they come and ask the scholars of Mecca, what about killing a mosquito in the haram? Would that nullify my hajj? You killed al-Hussein and you're asking us about mosquitoes? So he's saying, oh people of Iraq, listen. Oh people of Iraq, how strange it is that you ask about minor sins but commit major sins. I heard my father say that Rasulullah said, while pointing to the east, to the Najd of Medina, this is where the fitna will come from. So Salim understood from the hadith that the area is which area? Iraq. Say it loudly. Iraq. Now Imam al-Khattabi said, Najd pertains to areas lying to the east. Thus, the Iraqi desert and surrounding areas is the Najd of those who reside in Medina because it is to the east, northeast actually of Medina. Also Imam Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani and al-Dawoodi issued statements regarding Iraq being the location of the Najd mentioned in this ahadith. So then, I mean, what else is there to say? Oh, people of Iraq, you ask about minor sins, but you commit major sins. So the hadith is talking about Iraq. Now, throughout history, you tell me about, if you read a little bit about Islamic history, where did the fitan come from? One after another, until today. Where? Iraq. Did you hear in the history of Islam fitna after fitna coming from Najd? In a short period of time, they went back to the ways of shirk. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab, rahimahullah. He brought him back to Tawheed bi'idhni Allah Azza wa Jal. There is no major fitna but Iraq. Now al-Hajjaj, he goes to Iraq. And he learns from the ways of the people of Iraq, fitna and rebellion. What did they do? Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiyallahu anhu, moved the Khilafah from Medina to Al-Kufa because he thought he's going to be among his supporters. they wouldn't support him. Every time he wanted to do something, they would fail him, betray him, argue with him, until he said, I wished for death to come to me so that I can leave you. You just betrayed me, did everything wrong against what I want to do. They called Al-Husayn after the death of Ali, radiallahu anh. They called Al-Husayn to come to Iraq and told him, we'll support you. Some of the people who knew the people of Iraq said to him, don't go to Iraq. They failed your father, they failed your brother, and their hearts are with you, meaning they pretend to be like this, but their swords are against you. And they killed him. Among the major books of Shia today, they admit that it was the Shia who killed Al-Husayn. It's not us, it's the Shia. Go back to their history, you find that the soldiers who killed Al-Husayn were from the same Shia who told him, come here, we come here, we'll announce you the Khalifa, we'll support you. Subhanallah. Until today, you find some other aspects, brothers, that you should remember. Until today, this fitna is happening. Just yesterday, somebody asked me, how come those Sunni Muslims don't commemorate the death of Husayn? Because Ashura comes every year. Why don't the Sunnis mention that? By the way, Al-Husayn died during this day. So I said to him, those who are bigger in the religion than Al-Husayn died, we don't commemorate their death, starting with Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Abu Bakr. Umar was murdered by a Christian Persian. Some scholars said he wasn't Majusi, he was a Persian. Abu Lu'lu al-Majusi, it was a title. He killed Umar. And Uthman radiallahu anh was killed by Arab Muslims. What a shame. But we don't come every year and say this day Uthman was killed, because their religion is a religion of grief, you know, death and crying, you know, find something better to do, you know, someday you're happy. And they would sit and memorize, remember, you know, Al-Husayn, everything. The fitna came from Iraq all the way until today. Throughout the history, you saw so many states that rose and were destroyed. And many of them were Rafida, Sunni, Rafida, too much fitna, death and destruction in Iraq, but not in Najd. So two things. The Sahabi who narrated the hadith about Najd, his own son said it's about Iraq. And historically, the area of Najd didn't have nearly a fraction of the fitna that Iraq had. So the hadith is about Iraq.
Is it true that Abdul Wahab was responsible for destroying the graves, including the graves of the Sahaba?
Abdul Wahab was somewhat opposed to the da'wah of Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab. So I think you're asking about Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahab destroying the graves, meaning by taking the dead out and, you know. Well, this is a joke. Every time I went to a masjid in Texas, this guy came and followed me. Wherever I am there, he comes and says, first time I didn't know him, anyone has a question, he raises his hand. I said, okay, alhamdulillah. He took a 15-page question from his page, from his pocket, 15 pages. Started reading. What's happening, akhi? Is this one? Yeah, this all is one question. 15 pages. I mean, you're not going to read the whole thing. I don't have time for that, you know. Then he started shouting at me. I think it's stuck here. Started shouting at me. He said, those Wahhabis in Saudi Arabia, they're taking the bones of the Sahaba out of the graves and conducting DNA tests on them. What are you talking about? I mean, the topic wasn't even that. I said, how do you know they're the Sahaba? He said, what? I said, did you conduct DNA test and you found out they're the Sahaba? Muhammad al-Abdul Wahhab did not destroy the graves of the Sahaba. How did he do that? Monuments on graves is something else. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent the Sahaba, including Abu Sufyan and Ali ibn Abi Talib, to go to where graves are built up to demolish them. So if he did it, jazahullah khair. But how do you know it's the Sahaba? Monuments in the grave, how do you know it's the Sahaba? This is ridiculous, brothers. I mean, it doesn't make any sense. So jazakumullah khair, who asked the question, but this is the answer. Prove it. What can I say? Prove it. Why would they take, I mean, of all the graves in Arabia, they're only graves of the Sahaba? Millions of people died before and after. So how do you know they're the graves of Sahaba? No, they destroyed monuments on graves. May Allah reward them for that. This is the good tawheed that they brought back to the ummah.
A brother asked the question that what is the correct opinion for naming yourself with the names such as Ikhwani, Jumaat al-Tabligh, Salafis, so and so on.
Jazakallah khair, akhi. May Allah reward you. That's a good question. Imam Ibn Taymiyyah said, no one should be criticized for ascribing himself to a Salaf al-Salih by calling themselves Salafi. So the question that I would ask everyone here, who are a Salaf al-Salih? Help me here. Help me. Sahaba, Tabi'in, Tabi'i Tabi'in, led by Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So these are a Salaf al-Salih. According to the authentic mutawatir hadith, mutawatir is the highest grade of authentic hadith. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, khayrun nas, the best people, قرني are my generation, ثم الذين يلونهم, then the generation after that, ثم الذين يلونهم, then the generation after that. So when we say I'm a Salafi, I'm ascribing myself to that generation. I'm saying to you, this is what I want to follow. Their way, their manhaj, their understanding, practices. I couldn't be criticized for that because I'm not ascribing myself to a sheikh who started a hizb or a group. I'm ascribing myself to the best of all Muslims of all time, because when Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is with them, they outweigh any ummah that came before. So we're saying we follow the way of Salaf al-Salih. Now those who call themselves Tabligh Ikhwan, ask them, because I haven't called myself a Salafi. I'm ascribing myself to the way of Salaf al-Salih, and the way to do it in Arabic is to say Salafi. The ya here says, this is my manhaj, my way. By the way, who's the first to use the word Salaf of all the Muslims? Can you tell me? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Once Fatima came, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam asked for Fatima to come. She came. Aisha said she was walking the same way Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam walked. She, you know, looked a lot like the way Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam walked. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam gave her some news or something, told her something. She cried. Then he told her something and she left. Now, Aisha said, what did Rasulullah tell you? She said, I'm not going to convey the secret of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Aisha was so jealous, you know. I have to know what he told you. I can't tell you. After he died, she goes to Fatima and tell her, now he died. So tell me what he told you. Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam conveyed to Fatima this news that every year, Jibril used to come to me to review the Quran once during the month. Now this year he came twice. And I think this is because my time on this earth has come to an end. She cried. Then he told her, you will be the first from among my family to follow me, to die. And she left. But in between he said to her, you know, don't cry. He wanted to give her some kind words, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He said, you know, don't cry, because to you, I am the best Salaf, Bukhari and Muslim. So who used the word first? Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He is our, then you're a Salafi. He is your Salaf, then you're a Salafi. Salaf means ancestor. And the scholars of Islam always mention this term, as-Salafu al-Salih, as-Salafu al-Salih, as-Salafu al-Salih. Look in the books of the Imams of Islam. So today, all what I'm telling you, brother, I follow the way of Salaf al-Salih. But when you're looking at me saying this, think of Abu Bakr and Umar and Uthman and Ali and Fatima and Aisha and how they conducted the religion. Don't look at me and say, this man claims that he is the righteous one, he's going to Jannah, we're going to Jahannam. Because I'm not talking about me, I'm talking about the methodology you should follow. But my mistakes, of course I make mistakes. I hope to rise up to that level. And the Salafis who are here, and everybody should be a Salafi, ascribe yourself to a Salaf al-Salih. Don't think that because you're in it, you are saved. You have to behave yourself the way Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam conducted himself in the religion. If Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam practiced the akhlaq and Islamic manners, then we should. Aqeedah alone is not sufficient. You have to have aqeedah and action. Why? The scholars of Islam, including Aqeedah al-Tahawiyyah, inshallah ta'ala, they agree. Aqeedah al-Tahawiyyah had a problem there, but بإذن الله عز وجل, inshallah, when you explain it, inshallah, you'll understand what happened. That our religion is faith, statement and action. So the faith is the aqidah, statement is the words, and action, you behave yourself according to the Islamic manners. Do you understand, brothers, that the difference? The other groups, you ask them, they call the name after a sheikh, after a way, a Sufi, this is whatever. We don't care. We ascribe ourselves to a Salaf al-Salih. And they shouldn't criticize us for calling ourselves Salafis, but we should criticize them for calling themselves whatever it is they call themselves. Because they invented those names.
A real question. Is it true that the Wahhabis believe the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was an ordinary man like we are?
قُلْ إِنَّمَا أَنَا بَشَرٌ مِثْلُكُمْ. Say, O Muhammad, I am a human just like you. خلاص, I'm done. You need any more? Say, ayah, خلاص, you use it, inshallah.
Questions from the floor? Yes,
you know, the Sheikh, the Osmani Khilafah, did they rule the Ottoman Empire, and was that dismantled by Sheikh Abdul Wahhab?
I'm not sure. The Osmani Khilafah
were they the Ottoman Empire at the time?
Yeah, they are the Ottoman Empire. Yeah, because the Westerners, they corrupt the names, so Osman became Ottoman.
Right.
Yeah. And Arabic became Arabic, Masjid became Mosque, and who knows what they're going to come up with. Some scholars said that they do this on purpose, because when it gets to their tradition, they keep preserve their names. But when it comes to the names of things or aspects from other religions or people, they actually translate that. And you find that, for example, Jesus, the J here is typical of the Greek language. And they don't pronounce it, so it's Isas, you know, Jesus. The Spanish, they call him Jesus. The Arabic people call him Yesu', Isa Yesu'. They just moved the letters back and forth to come up with a name that nobody called him before, but they have a sickness in doing that. Therefore, Jazakallah khair. The Ottoman Empire is the Uthmani Khilafah, the same one.
A written question here, it says that, is it true that current rulers of Saudi Arabia are slowly destroying Islamic history?
No, it's not true. What are they doing? I need examples. What are they doing? Don't tell me they're moving the bones of the Sahaba. We're done with that. The houses that people, Sahaba used to live in, these houses, you can't say about any house in all of Arabia that this belonged to the Sahaba or that Sahabi, because centuries passed and Mecca went through destruction of houses and rebuilding, and Kaaba itself was rebuilt 3 times. You know that? One during the time of Rasulullah Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, before he became a prophet, and 2 times after that, including during the time of Zubair, Abdullah ibn Zubair radiallahu anhu. So destroying houses of people, we don't revere houses, we don't revere relics of people, they don't mean anything. So maybe people before Islam, they had, you know, they would have girlfriends from this tribe who was residing in this area, then they move, go after, take the cattle to go somewhere else where there is water and grass for their cattle. They would come by and start crying, I kiss that wall, I kiss that wall and that wall, because she's not there anymore. Alhamdulillah, in Islam, we don't have this. So you live in a house for 20 years, it's just a building, habibi. Move and khalas, don't look back. So they destroyed the Islamic history. I doubt they're doing akhib. Brothers, always ask for the proof, you know, just proof. They say something, what's the proof? I'm not the defender of the rulers in Saudi Arabia. They can defend themselves. But if you want to say anything about it, just give me the proof, because I can't really answer this question, because I don't know what is it that they're destroying.
Any questions from the floor? Take another written question. It says that some people say that Sheikh Mohammed bin Abdul Wahhab was responsible for killing over 12,000 ulama. Is this true?
If Arabia had 12,000 ulama during that time, it must be a magnificent place to live in. 12,000 scholars in Arabia? No, this is again, give me the proof. And what ulama that are they talking about? So he collected 12,000 ulama from Najd. And then maybe the same person who started this rumor would say, Najd is the area of fitan, but it had 12,000 scholars. And Ibn Abdul Wahhab killed them. There's no proof to that. It's only false, fabricated rumors. No proof to that. And I can assure you, Ariba didn't have that many scholars. And Ibn Abdul Wahhab did not kill a single scholar who called to Tawheed. I challenge everyone to come and bring a single name that he killed a scholar. Or even from the shuyukh who opposed him, he was kind to them. He was always writing to them, advising them, reminding them. And many times he would be patient more than he should have with them being patient and calling them. But 12,000 scholars in Arabia, in Najd, this is, what can I say, ridiculous. Wallah. Just one quick, this book is about the pillars of Iman and pillars of Islam and how Allah preserved the Quran and Sunnah from corruption. This one is a response to the attack by the Pope on our Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. We mentioned 50 different doubts that or things that Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam came with. Compared that to the Old Testament and New Testament. We have a website, islamlife.com. We have thousands of articles there, many booklets, especially debating Christians who attack the religion and Jews. On the website, you can take them for free, booklets for free. Also, we have debates on YouTube. We have, you know, with the evangelicals. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to give us knowledge in the religion, make us among the righteous. Amen. And the dua to save when we finish audiences and classes. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illa ant astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.